If they can't remember their code, they're gonna have to get an Uber somewhere else, because that's crazy.
First thing you're gonna notice is we've got a cat. So, okay. And there it goes. And we wanted a place for our cat to be happy, so.
And the way that we're doing this is through Facebook Messenger. So some people.
And then here's my number one trick. You better have you some VI poo, okay? Now what's VI poo, you might say?
What is up, you guys? Matt McKeever here in London, Ontario, and you can see behind me is Adam and Miranda. So you may remember them from my channel earlier videos. We discussed Adam and Miranda bought this house with a vendor take-back mortgage, and they're actually house hacking it. So today we're going to chat with them about house hacking, having roommates, and getting your living situation to pay for your lifestyle. So, what's up, guys?
Hey, what's up, you guys? I want to take you through a tour of our house and really show you what we're doing to house hack this property so that we can live for free.
Here we go. Come on in.
Hey guys, so one of the first things you're going to want to do when you're house hacking is actually get keyless entry set up, because the worst thing that can happen to you is a text at 2 a.m. That's the classic horror story from every one of your relatives that warned you about actually getting set up for rentals. So what we did here is a keyless entry system. Every single tenant has their own unique code on here, and that way I really don't ever have to answer any of those texts or calls midnight, 2 a.m., 3 a.m., coming home from the bar and they can't get in the house. If they can't remember their code, they're gonna have to get an Uber somewhere else, because that's crazy. Coming into the common space here, first thing you're gonna notice is we've got a cat. So tenant selection is definitely limited when you've got a cat, but we decided that this house is going to be ours, and what we really wanted to do was kind of take over the space. But this is common area for everybody, so some of the things that we had to consider when doing this is, you know, obviously if you're house hacking, you're going to be leaving out some valuables. So we've got the big flat screen here, we've got the audio system, we've got a bunch of our belongings, and if you can even believe this, we've got an open bar set up here in a student rental. So that kind of sounds a little bit crazy, but the way we got over some of those fears or some of those challenges was actually through selecting our tenants properly. And that comes down to actually vetting them properly and making sure that you've got the right ones. Now, I'm not saying we're an expert at this, because we've already had to kick one out, and we'll go over that in another video and tell you more about what we're doing with that. But first, let's go to the kitchen.
So yeah, I think this is one of the biggest concerns everyone has, is sharing their kitchen space. So
yeah, so sharing the kitchen space can be really challenging if you don't set up the ground rules right away. So what we did was actually set up the ground rules through example, right? Lead through example. So if you want to have a clean kitchen, you want to have a clean space, you want to have a space that you can interact with other people in, and people are happy to come in here and cook and use dishes or whatever, and they're not afraid. Because right away, like when you think of a student rental, you don't necessarily think about the most clean space. When you think about house hacking, probably one of your objections is, well, how am I going to keep this space myself to my own standards, right? And the way you do that is by actually setting the example and leading them by making sure every time there's a dish out, you just clean it. And if somebody's whining or somebody's not pulling their weight, you continue to show them through example that that's the standard we're going for here. So another couple of tips when you're house hacking is to try and avoid doing all the work yourself, because these guys are paying to live here, but they're not paying to override my experience, okay? I still want a good experience while I'm living here, and we still want a nice friendly house that everybody kind of contributes in. So one of the ways to do that is to make it easy for everybody. And we've made it easy here by just putting out our garbage schedule. Something as simple as that can actually really help you to kind of mitigate the amount of effort you're gonna have to put in to setting this space up properly. So garbage schedule here, these are students that are renting. Oh, okay. And there it goes. And these are students that are renting here. So we've got pizza, right on speed dial, right on the fridge. So that's perfect. Now this is a 5-bedroom, 2-bath house. So you'll notice there's one kitchen up here. So one of the things we did to actually alleviate the impact on us and on our experience was we put another fridge downstairs, and we've actually got another fridge in our other room as well. So little tips like that, little tricks like that, it might cost you a few $100 to get it set up, but it seriously impacts your experience day to day. So that's really important for both you and your tenants. Another thing to consider is, you know, what resources are being used by who. So to make it really easy and to make things actually really nice for us, what we did is we actually just set up all of the all of the cutlery, all of the plates, all the glasses ourselves. So it looks kind of crazy, but they'll never run out of glasses. They'll never worry about glasses or plates. There's two different sets in there. Typically we try and keep the basement using one set, and then we use another set. And then in another video, we'll actually talk about our Airbnb room, which has its own set of everything. So its own utensils and everything. And that's kind of how you get house hacking set up. It's all about setting up these little, like these small amenities that are really going to help your day out. So, I mean, we provided these things. We've got a toaster, magic bullet, toaster oven, anything a student might need. We got a spice rack. We've got all the utensils, Keurig, that's huge. And it's like, you know, you might put in an extra $1,000 into getting the extra fridge, to getting the extra utensils, to getting the plates and glasses and everything. But once you have those, it's really a low maintenance kind of strategy that keeps everybody happy. It keeps everybody using the same stuff. And it's really easy to manage. So I'll take you downstairs and I'll show you a bit more about the kitchenette. Now, again, guys, we're house hacking to students here. So I think there's a bit of a difference between the common areas and what areas that we've chosen to give up to them. So you'll see right away, they've got a slightly different standard of cleanliness downstairs in their own space, but that doesn't matter to us, guys, because we are living for free here. So you can get caught up in these little details as much as you want, but at the end of the day, you got to really focus on what's this costing you, what would it have cost you otherwise, and what's the difference, like what's the real benefit between owning your own space and having somebody pay the bills for you, or versus you just renting that space, right? So I could have been renting this for maybe $1,500 for the whole house, or our rent here is actually $2,250 including everything. But you know, the difference is massive when you take that net benefit from renting into owning it, having somebody pay your bills for you. So coming on downstairs, you'll notice right away, we did not put too much attention into kind of making this space perfect, because that's not what these guys wanted. These guys wanted a quick solution that allowed them to live in a pretty nice space. Now the bedrooms themselves, we're not gonna be able to go into because obviously that's their space. And they've actually done, we've actually done all the improvements in the bedrooms. So the bedrooms are 100% finished. Everything's luxury vinyl plank flooring. And they've got their own bathroom in there. So that's, again, really key when it comes to reducing the impact that your tenants or the people that you're going to be house hacking with have on your experience, as well as their experience. Because you've got to think, every day, if there's 5 tenants in here, everybody has to shower. Right? Everybody has to go to the bathroom in the morning. Everybody has to make a coffee or whatever, all these daily routine things. So having that extra bathroom for them down here, as well as having this kind of kitchenette set up, is really key to actually reducing the impact on all of our experiences in this building. So down here we've included laundry. So we've got a new washer and dryer. Our original one was actually ripping people's clothes. So there's one thing right there. If you're gonna be house hacking, you do have to be aware that certain things need to be up to a certain standard. So if your washer is ripping clothes randomly, it's gotta go, okay? So don't waste any time doing that, because the minute you get an upset culture in here, or there starts to be politics that are going negatively, it's gonna negatively impact your life. So all you do, buy new appliances. Just do it. Just put the money out. It's $1,000, but you get to live for free every single month. Always remember that. So what we did, washer, dryer, we've got this thing here. It's kind of like a laundry tub. They can use it also to wash their dishes. And then we've just got little hot plates set up. Now you can see that they've kind of gone a little crazy with this. Like it's a little bit messy down here, but honestly, I don't care. And if they don't care, if they're happy with this, I'm happy. We got them a stainless fridge. It's a bit on the smaller side, but there's only two people using it, so it actually works out perfect for them. But other than that, let's go back upstairs, because there's one more thing I wanted to touch on, is we actually have to share a bathroom upstairs. So I'll show you that and how we manage that. Yeah, so now we're standing here in the bathroom, and this is actually the main floor bathroom that's shared with all of us. So the two downstairs tenants have their own bathroom, but then Miranda and I and Mike have to share this one as well as our Airbnb guests. So some simple hacks for the bathroom are get a nice curtain. We actually didn't spend any money renovating the shower. So you notice that the shower is kind of an older style, but you can really distract from that by using a nice curtain. And if you're house hacking, people are gonna be fine with that. They don't need granite countertops. They don't need glass standing showers. They don't need all of those really fancy things typically. If you're house hacking, like these tenants, the candidates that you're going for are probably not like your executive rental type. So just doing small, cheap, cost-effective things like this can really help you out, especially if you're trying to keep your costs down. So just get a nice shower curtain, get a nice little organizer for inside the shower so that everybody can have all their products, but it's kind of segregated, so everybody knows what they're up to. And then here's my number one trick, and I'm sorry I gotta reach past you guys here, but you guys gotta get onto this. So if you're gonna be sharing a bathroom with multiple people, you better have you some VI poo. Okay, now what's VI poo, you might say? Well, VI poo is gonna be shamelessly promoted here, because if you're gonna use a shared bathroom, one of the objections you might have is, oh boy, like what happens if I need to use the bathroom right after someone else? Isn't that gonna stink or whatever? Well, not with VI poo, because you just give that thing three sprays in there and it's like nothing ever happened. So little house hacks like that, or little hacks for your house hacking, are gonna be really important, again, for managing your experience and really getting the most out of your rentals. So I figured I'd throw that in for you guys. That's a pro tip. But yeah, so I'll take you back into the main room here and we'll talk a little bit more about politics and sort of what's going on in the building and how you guys can manage that in your own buildings and house hacking moving forward.
So let's sit down and chat about some of the issues that I often get in comments on my channel when we talk about house hacking and a lot of the common problems. So the first thing a lot of people seem to get caught up in is your house is your castle, and the idea of letting anyone into your castle, you have to be insane. So do you guys mind kind of talking through, were you both on the same page right at the start? How did you guys decide that this was the right fit for you?
Yeah, take it away.
Yeah, so I was sold on the idea as soon as we figured out that we're gonna be living for free and even making money. So that immediately was a big motivator for me to say yes.
Yeah, for sure. So I think the idea with us too, and it was really clear as soon as we closed on this property that, you know, when you look at this building, there's five bedrooms, there's two bathrooms, both are full bathrooms, all the rooms are really good size, like they're all a minimum of 10 by 10. So when I started looking at this house as one comprehensive unit, it was really hard to imagine what we would do with all of that space and where that would kind of take us. So I knew right away, if it was just gonna be the two of us in this house, it'd be really hard to fill all those rooms with the resources that we had. Yeah. And, you know, without going completely overboard on buying new, like you'd have to set up a theater room downstairs. You'd have to have probably a useless, either a spare room or like some kind of room that would probably end up just being full of junk.
Yeah, it's a problem we talk about all the time, right? People buy these new McMansions and then they need to go buy all brand new furniture in order to fill out the mansion, right?
Yeah. And we wanted a place for our cat to be happy, so.
We need to be front and center.
But no, it is a real problem, and I think people don't really consider that. Is like, you know, you get this big house, and then at the end of the day, you're not going to leave those rooms empty. I don't care who you are, you're not
it's
going to do it.
About, like, yeah,
it's weird.
Yeah.
It's really weird to do that.
Yeah.
So obviously, you have to end up sharing some of your space, and when you get back to the kind of castle talk, and when you get back to the argument that, you know, my house is my castle, it's sacred, people can't come in it, I think maybe it's fine to have that approach, but you should probably have yourself financially there before you decide that it's right time to do it right now.
Yeah.
And we certainly weren't there. So
I think the biggest thing I'd love to hit home right is it's not your castle if you don't got it paid for. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you guys are paying for your castle so much faster than the average person would, simply because you're able to create revenue and income stream from it rather than it simply being an expense.
Yeah, exactly. And that actually allows us too to make a lot more smarter decisions on the purchasing end of things, right? Like now we're looking at everything as a business expense. Like, would I buy this for a business. Like, as a business decision, does this purchase make sense? And often I think you'll find right away you're now cutting down on half the stuff you would have bought anyways. Mm-hmm. Like, you're not buying some crazy leather couch to go in here, right? Yeah. Or some $4,000 couch because it looks great and it's comfy, mm-hmm. right? You're not buying these crazy luxury items that don't make sense. Like, you're actually now forced to be more conscientious. Like, can I afford this? Should mm-hmm. I afford this? Is this something that, you know, needs to happen? And often I think people are just buying stuff to fill their space.
Yeah.
Or fill their ego, which again leads mm-hmm. into another set of problems. But from a financial independence perspective, this is fantastic because every month we collect $2,250 of rent, but we also, on our mortgage payment, so our mortgage payment's $1,250, but of that $1,250, these guys are going to work to pay for that, and over $600 of that is actually principal being paid mm-hmm. down that we just don't even account for. Like, yeah. we view the whole mortgage still as an expense, but really we're actually profiting half of that. So
yeah, and I think that that's just really big, that people really understand that this is part of a bigger picture for you, right?
Yeah.
This isn't simply the end.
Yeah.
Right? Like, it's not that you see yourself necessarily living in this house forever. This is just another stepping stone, right?
Exactly. And I think even if you were to stay here only for a year or so, well, now there's different tax implications. There's different implications to just getting into a space, managing it, getting the system running nicely, and then you can move out and maybe house hack a new property. And I think that's kind of the idea we want to go with, because it also keeps you sort of more minimalist. Like, it keeps your stuff reduced.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's a great strategy for us because we are mobile, even though we've got the cat, we do have a lot of stuff. But it was also really important for us too, to get in here and kind of get this building set up with the right tenants, with the right kind of political environment in here, and just get these various things set up, like get the garbages set up, get these lists posted on the fridge, get a cleanliness standard set for the mm-hmm. common areas and all those various things. And again, once you do that, it really is kind of your castle. Like, mm-hmm. we primarily have this space to ourselves. Like, when they come home, they just go to their rooms.
Yeah.
Because they're set up for that.
Yeah, and that's the way a lot of millennials actually interact in their day-to-day,
yeah.
right? Whether they're living at home or in their own apartment or, you know, on campus, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, there are some drawbacks, too. I mean, you know, last night somebody went to the bathroom at 1:30 in the morning, and I'm a light sleeper, so I wake up for that. Right? Mm-hmm. Somebody, they got pizza here at 1 a.m. And so, like, I woke up for that. But, like, at the end of the day, if you can get over those small petty things mm-hmm. and actually take a bigger look at the strategy behind what you're doing with your money and your investments, then it makes sense to me. Like, I will take, you know, some cash flow every month and living for free over having to wake up a couple of times, you know, mm-hmm. versus just paying for this ourselves or trying to pay for this ourselves
yeah.
and really not getting any benefit out of the building other than a private shelter.
Yeah. Do you guys have some tips for living with roommates then? Let's actually like run through, like, maybe Miranda, if you can share a couple yeah. of your favorite tips and Adam a couple of yours.
So I would definitely say, so we've lived with roommates for a long time, just
yeah.
throughout school and whatnot. So we were only on our own for a year, and now we're back into living with roommates. So it's not like a huge change. But I would definitely say I was always the house mom
yeah.
in the other houses. So I've kind of taken on that here as well, like cleaning up and stuff like that. But as far as just living with roommates, you just have to respect their space. You want to be friendly, but you don't need to be their best friend. So the small talk is good, but you don't need to get into their life stories.
Personal lives, yeah.
Kind of leave it there. Yeah, overall it's been really good. You just kind of let them do their thing. You do their, like, your thing. Mm-hmm. And definitely with what we've done here, own the space that you want to.
Yeah.
Kind of set that standard.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's all about setting the standard up right from the beginning. So right from the beginning, you know, set the standard that you want to see come out of it. So if you have to live with roommates, don't let them mm-hmm. leave dishes everywhere. Don't let them leave a mess everywhere. Don't let them, you know, not do certain things around the house that you would expect anybody contributing to a house would.
And so something I'd like to build on that. So I'd love to hear your approach to it, right? Because
yeah.
it's a lot in how you handle that situation.
Yeah.
It depends on what you get out of that situation. Because if you just like throw the dishes on their bed and you're like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah.
You know, like versus
yeah.
how you actually approach it.
And I know one of my friends lived in a frat house going to school. And what they would do is if people were leaving dishes around, they would just throw them in the recycling bin. right? Mm-hmm. Like, it's gone. It's garbage now. It's gone. Yeah. And I don't think that approach really creates a long-term happy situation. Mm-hmm. So what we've chosen to do is, because we've actually provided all of the resources, it's been really easy for us to frame it as sort of an opportunity, or... Like it's not a privilege that we've provided all of these things. So in the framing for it, it's like, hey guys, you know, I'm really disappointed. One of my exact messages was, hey guys, I'm pretty disappointed. You know, I don't mind that you use our cutlery, our dishes, our glasses, and all of that stuff. But when I come downstairs and I see this, because there was a pile of dishes downstairs, and actually it had attracted like a bunch of fruit flies and stuff. Yeah. And so I'm like, but when I see this, you know, I get really disappointed, because, you know, we've got a certain standard and that's what we'd like to do. And really it has a negative impact on you guys too, because it's clutter in your space, it doesn't look great, and it's getting all these flies into your space. So, you know, let's try and manage that so that everybody can have a great environment. And right away it's like, okay, you know, he's not being rude, he's not being aggressive, he's not being mean, he's not attacking me, he's really just giving me his point and saying, you know, it'd be great if we can clean this up. And when you do that but like when you do that at the same time as setting the standard for everybody else by example, it's really easy for them to hold that standard. So,
and the way that we're doing this is through Facebook Messenger. So some people, some people can do their text messages or different platforms. We're using Facebook Messenger and it works really well. We just have a group with the house name, the address, and we kind of just interact through there.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a great tip, actually.
Keeps it clear.
Yeah, it's fantastic. I mean, you want to have constant communication whenever you need it with your tenants, and that's really important, just to make sure everybody's on the same page. It allows us to update people on, you know, if someone's coming by. So, like, for example, we'd have thrown into the chat, like, hey, we're doing filming today.
Okay, awesome.
Please try and reduce the impact on the building. Like, if you can stay away for a minute, great. Mm-hmm. Like, this is when we should start, this is when we should finish.
Yeah.
You know, we've got an Airbnb guest coming. Well, they're staying from this time until this time. Like, please take extra care of the space, right? And be respectful of that space. And I think that's done us really well.
That's awesome. Yeah, I love it. You guys have set a great example for other young couples that maybe are thinking about how to get control of their financial lives and how to speed things up. Because what I love is, this is really just like property number one in your portfolio.
Yeah.
And you're going to build your portfolio off of this. So unlike a lot of situations where people buy that first house
to make mansion,
and then they have to go sell it and they incur all those costs, right? You got realtor fees, you got land transfer tax, all sorts of costs associated with it. Whereas with you, you're just going to move out and you'll rent out the bedroom you live in, right?
Yeah, exactly. And you know, a lot of that does actually come down to as well making a smart investment. Right, so we bought this property 10 minutes away from the school. Like, it's a 10-minute walk, so it's a 4, maybe 5-minute drive if you get a red light.
Yeah.
So, like, setting up your purchase strategically is important there too. And you know, we did really well on doing that. So no matter what, we've got a strategy, an exit strategy for this building, and a proper business case to own this building. So it's important to factor that in as well.
So before we wrap up this video, one last thing I want to touch upon was, what's the actual financial impact to your lives? Like, we've talked about it in other videos, but there's a lot of new viewers now to my channel. So, like, you know, versus when you were living and renting out that, was it a 2-bedroom apartment?
Yes.
Versus today.
So before we moved here, we had a 1-bedroom apartment in Guelph that was really nice and it was private. So it was just us. So obviously you get some social capital or mental capital there, but it was $1,100 a month and we had to pay for internet on top of that. And if they hadn't messed our paperwork up, we would have been paying probably another $100 or $200 a month for parking. Because we actually have a lot of vehicles too. So we've got we've got a truck and a car and 2 motorcycles. So like right away you're paying parking, you're paying crazy rates for that in the city. So that was $1,100 plus internet, so let's call it $1,150 or something a month. And then when we moved here and actually got it operating, once the rent's coming in, I think so right away we're not spending $1,100, but now we're also getting at least $2,250 in. Now after expenses, you know, we've paid for this house, it's free and clear, the house is free, Okay, yeah. And then we still get the benefit of probably $400 a month in cash flow. So, and that doesn't factor in CapEx, because I know you're going to comment about it, but honestly, it doesn't matter, because it just doesn't. The roof's great, everything else is great. Stop bothering me about CapEx, goddamn. Stop getting hung up on minutia and just make an investment. Yeah. Buy your first property, don't worry about CapEx. I'm going to get burned in the comments about this, but honestly, it's not a thing. But yeah, so I think overall though, our big impact on our finances is we're not paying for shelter. So that $1,150 doesn't come out of the account every month. And instead, we own the property. It's already had a ton of natural appreciation and forced appreciation. Because in one of the exact same houses, like just around this crescent, has just sold for $299. We bought this for $240.
Yeah.
So
I
like
you turned around in their laneway to get here.
Perfect. So like right away, you know, that's a big financial impact if we for some reason had to sell. Mm-hmm. But I think the overall net benefit is somewhere around $2,000, right? Because mm-hmm. we're not paying for that rent anymore. Yep. We're now getting the benefit of equity being paid down every month.
About 600 400 in cash flow.
400 in cash flow. So right there, you know, it's about $2,000 net benefit.
So like, this is what I really want to hit home for people. Think about it this way. If you could work a part-time job that netted you $2,000 essentially after taxes, let's ignore taxes for this, $2,000 after taxes, and all you had to do was live with roommates, like, could you do it?
Yeah.
That seems like a pretty decent job, realistically.
It's fantastic.
Right?
Well, and you're going to live somewhere anyways. Mm-hmm. And realistically, like, at this level of lifestyle, you probably have a roommate, mm-hmm. right? So why not own the space? So I think it really just comes down to, you know, finding out some strategies for you to raise that down payment, or finding strategies to, you know, source the capital to get into it, and then make a good purchase. So
yeah.
Have a strategy is really all it comes down to.
Those are great tips. If you guys enjoyed this video, smash that like button. Hit the subscribe button if you're new to my channel. And otherwise, they can actually find both of you guys on Instagram, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so I'm at AdamJDMartin.
And I'm at Miranda Drexler.
And Miranda's actually got a YouTube channel as well, so you can jump over there.
Oh, yeah.
Just your name?
Yep, just Miranda Drexler.
Awesome. So, thank you guys for watching. Honestly, more people need to be thinking about house hacking. They need to be thinking about getting roommates, or maybe even Airbnb if you don't like the idea of roommates. And we're going to do another video because they've actually switched one of their bedrooms now to Airbnb to up their returns and kind of increase your flexibility, right?
Yeah, absolutely. It's great.
So, we'll get that video. Look forward to it. Smash that like button. Hit subscribe so you can see the next one. And until next time, remember, make money as a team sport. There's more than enough money in this world for us to all make it. But if you're not saving it, I mean, like, what's the point, guys? Thanks. Bye.
Love it. That was good.